and implementing a data science solution. So I hope you all can hear me.
Yes, Priyanka.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Thank you so much. So before we start today's session, I would like to give you some introduction about our series and our today's speaker. So today, organized under Lives Are Trades webinar series, and this is organized by Synergetics. So just give me a second. So this is the today's webinar is under Azure Tech Community, and if you want to follow our community, then please visit Meetup site, and there you can find our two communities. One is Emerging Technology Community and Azure Tech Community Pune. So those who are not from Pune, please follow our Emerging Technology Community. So from there you will directly get updates about our upcoming meetups and events. So there is a small code of conduct. You cannot click the images of the presentation which is shared by the speaker, and you cannot do the recordings of the session. So basically, about today's webinar, DP100, designing and implementing a data science solution on Azure. So basically, today's agenda is Azure data scientists apply their knowledge of data science and machine learning to implementing and running machine learning workloads on Azure. So Ms. Chitra will guide you correctly on this. So she is the speaker for today's webinar, and Chitra is a data all-rounder with unique blend of experience in multitude of data-related technology. She has immense knowledge and understanding of technologies like big data analytics, data lake, warehousing, then SQL, machine learning, then data science, with extensive technical experience of more than 15 years in this IT industry. She has worked with various Fortune companies like Accenture, Infosys, then L&T, Sintel, Capgemini, and many more companies. She has trained n number of employees from these companies. So my words are very less to describe her great work and experience in this industry. So she will the best person to guide you about this DP100 certification and their key skills and other aspects. So before today's webinar, I would like to tell you we have completed our live AI on Azure meetup series. So maybe many of you have already attended this series, and many of you have maybe not have attended this series. So if you want the recordings of this series, we are going to publish these recordings on YouTube, but it will take some time. So if you want the recordings immediately, so just give me a mail that you need the recordings. After that, we will send the links of these recordings with you. So you first need to mail me your details and that you need the recordings of these sessions. So as I told you, we took initiatives, and under this initiatives we have started this certification series, then one AICA meetup series, and other one is Azure Python workshop series. So under this workshop series, there are two webinars and two workshops. So one webinar is already completed, and we have shared this recording on our YouTube channel. So you just need to visit our YouTube channel and please try to subscribe that. And we are having one more workshop which is tomorrow, 20 June 2020, and this workshop is from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. This is a whole day free live workshop training on Python. So if you haven't registered, please register, or you can just give me a mail so we can share the attendee link. One more small announcement regarding Microsoft has started a data and AI certification campaign. Under this campaign, the mentioned four courses. You need to complete this certificate, one of this certification in between 19th May to 26th June. And one lucky winner will stand a chance to win Microsoft Surface Go. If you want more information, visit our site or you can also give me a mail or our concerned person, so we will share the details with you. We have also started online training, virtual training in this COVID situation. All we are working from home, so we have started online training of the you can see a calendar with the different certifications and courses. So you will get all these courses in just rupees 17,500, and it will includes the live training plus MOC plus exam voucher. For more details, you can also mail me or you can mail Shilpa Awad. We had share her number and email ID on the screen. So you can directly contact her and just tell her that you have attended this meetup and you get this discount offer from this meetup or webinar. So thank you. And one last announcement about the participation certificate. So if you want the participation certificate, just mail me your details, because if many of you haven't registered for this series, so just mail me your details. After that, I am going to mail you a feedback form. Once you have, you all have come filled the feedback form, you will get the participation certificate, and it will take some time to send you a participation certificate, because many times it happens that we send a feedback form mail but it didn't receive by you, or it may goes in your junk folder. So in that case, you haven't received previous participation certificate, just let me know you have attended these meetups or webinars and you didn't receive a participation certificate. So thank you once again for joining today's webinar. Chitra ma'am, you can start with the session now.
Thank you, Priyanka. Hi, good afternoon, everybody. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. And just help me, I'm just sharing the screen. Tell me whether you all are able to view it as well. Is the PPT visible? Is my screen visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Sure. Thank you. Yeah, hi. Once again, welcome to today's session. Today, the agenda is just to have a brief understanding about what is Azure Machine Learning Service and what are all the kind of workloads that you can deal with it in the machine learning service environment as such, and how you can train a model and deploy the same and come up with predictions and consume the deployed model in the different scenarios. Yeah, that's the agenda. So I believe most of you, since you're attending this, I believe all of you have a background in as cloud computing. Basically, cloud computing is a platform which offers three different main, which has three characteristics, and it offers three services as well. Infrastructure as a service. Yeah.
I'm able to see the PowerPoint.
I've just switched back to the meet screen. Yeah.
Thank
now,
you.
Yeah. So basically, the agenda is we'll be discussing, we'll be starting off with the basics as what is cloud computing, and we would move on to discuss the different kind of services offered by cloud computing, and we will understand the key concepts and terminologies associated with Azure Machine Learning Service, which is a prerequisite or which is a mandatory aspect to appear for this certification. Yeah, and we will talk about the kind of patterns that would be a part of the certification as well. That's the agenda. So when we talk about cloud computing, can you share me your experiences or your thought process on what is cloud computing? Hello, anybody?
Yeah, it's I would like to give my thought on this.
Sure,
it's nothing but it's mostly related to the infrastructure. And when there is a variation in the demand of the infrastructure and where the client cannot afford or don't want to maintain the hardware, then there is an option nowadays for cloud computing where we can rent, we can say like we can rent the infrastructure online and run our applications on throughout it. And it can be scaled out or scale up or scale out as well. So that's my thought on this. So it's basically an elastic and then secure and then I think cost saving as well solution as of now.
Yeah, basically the moment we say talk about cloud computing platform, so this cloud computing is, it should have, for us to regard something as a cloud computing aspect, it should have some certain basic characteristics as you had summarized a few of them. First is, it is pay per use. Whatever I'm going to use, only for that much I'm going to pay. Because earlier, prior to cloud computing, we were having hosting models as well, where people were able to, as he said, avail the infrastructure and all other aspects before also. This has been in the industry for the past 25 years, right? When .NET framework got introduced around that time onwards, hosting is available. But the costing itself is different, where you will have to take up a lease in hosting, and which probably might involve a minimum period of, let's say, a year, where whether you're going to use it or not, you have to pay for that entire year's lease amount. Whereas in cloud computing, in any of the public cloud, whatever is the amount of resources you're going to use for the whatever stipulated time you have used, only for that much you're going to pay, so which is pay per use. Second, it should provide you with the elasticity, I would say, as he referred to it as scale out and scale in, depending on the need of the hour. When there is a lot of concurrent hits and requests or via the application, I should be in a position to scale out resources to meet the demand or the peak in demand. And once the demand is over, I should be able to come in. Yeah, Virendra.
Yeah, so Chitra, again, I see the participant list on the screen.
Yeah, yeah. I'm not taking through the slide deck. I just discussed the agenda there. That's it. Now?
Yes, now I can see it. Thank you.
Right. Yeah. So basically, when we say cloud computing, there are different types of services Microsoft gives you. So out of that, cloud platform is also one of it. Via cloud platform environment, they offer you three services, which is infrastructure as a service, and you have a platform as a service and software as a service. Yeah, these are the three cloud services provided by Azure Cloud Platform. And when we talk about, let me switch over to MS Paint. A board would have been ideal, but now with the virtual session, let's do with this. So ideally, whenever I say I need to have my computing or IT environment ready, you would be dealing with different servers. Yeah. And you would want to make those servers communicate with each other. So the networking is also taken care of. And of course, storage of data, you would need the storage as well. So when you have the storage, also you would want to have virtualization between your different environment or different applications and so on and so forth. So when a particular cloud provider tells you that I would offer you, I would help you with these aspects, it could be there are many players in the market, including Microsoft, you have Amazon, you have Google, you have Oracle, there are n number. So in that, when they tell you in a public cloud that we would offer you with all these information or all these resources, this entire stack is called as infrastructure as a service or IaaS in short. So, but in this, only these entire stack of products the provider will manage, but whatever is the platform, which is the OS and the middle tier and the data, varying different data generated by that applications in the middle tier, all that would be my headache or the individual who has opted for it. So the person, you will have to worry about licensing, applying updates and patches, maintaining, providing for high availability by, you know, having a and have DR solutions, and then ensure that your entire environment is highly available. All this is our headache, where we need to look after the managing, maintenance, and it would also involve upfront investment in the costing, right? A software licenses and so on and so forth. And I will be responsible for meeting the SLA on these aspects. So if I expect the cloud provider, apart from the basic stack, I want the cloud provider to help me out with the platform and help me out with the, let's say, the middle tier applications. It could be a database server, it could be a reporting server, it could be an application server. So whatever is the middle tier in I need, that also I want provider to take care of it for me. And over and above, I will also want the data generated by that also to be maintained by that person. So when this entire whole set of products are considered, all these layers are considered, and they are provided to me by any cloud provider, we call it as platform as a service or PaaS. Besides this, I want some customized applications and the data generated by it, something like our, say, email server. So I want to, we all are using some email service or other. So let's say I'm talking, the oldest one which people have been using and aware of is the Gmail. So if Gmail, if I want, and the data, whatever email communications I've generated via that software, also I want that provider to maintain. So whenever we write, create emails and share communications with people via Gmail, do we ever worry about where these servers are available, across which region they are located, what will happen if there is an outage, power outage in one of those data centers, my request will be serviced. Nothing of it. We don't lose sleep over any of these things, because all these are the headache of the service provider. So the email application plus the data, whatever that is generated by that, is also the headache of the cloud provider. That is when we call it as software as a service. So these are the three cloud services which are provided by Microsoft Azure platform, which is a cloud computing environment platform. Any questions so far? To work with computers, we need machines. And inherently, let me just give you some basic concepts quickly here. Inherently, no two computers can ever talk to each other. How do we then make them communicate with each other? When you have two different laptops or two different desktop or one laptop, one desktop, how do you make them talk to each other? Because they cannot inherently communicate with each other, right? So how do we make them communicate with each other? Can anybody help me?
Mm-hmm.
by bringing them into the same network.
Correct. So how do we bring those systems into the network? Excellent. How do we bring them into a network? For example, let's say we all are multilingual. Yeah, tell me.
No, each computer has an address, right? IP address or something like that. It's a big topic to explain. But however, in a nutshell, right, actually, each in the network, each node knows about the details of the other node. And when you create a network and join these things with a specified network address, all these nodes can communicate within each other. And actually, the protocols will help in the communication.
Correct. But how do I bring it in? With the help of NIC, right? Network interface card. It could be Ethernet, Arctic, exactly. Whatever. But with that only, they come in, they gain an IP address. And even after the systems have been brought into a network, where exactly does the communication takes place? How exactly does the communication takes place? Via socket at a particular port, right? These are what are nowadays called as fancifully endpoints. Yeah, I'm bringing it to your notice because that's a terminology which you shall be using while working within AML for this. And one more quick thing I want to bring it to all your notices. After spending sadly 35 years in the industry, I have learned it the hard way that the concepts have never changed right from Adam and Eve days. Only the terminology that we use, depending on the technology we use, put it to use for coming up with our solution, these terminologies differ. For example, as it has so happened that network protocol, OSI layer, we know at physical layer, communication takes place at the socket level via port, which are nowadays called as endpoint. Something simple like that, let's say, whenever we are communicating with a database, we would be writing queries, right? So how do you ask for data from a database table? Just to draw a parallel here. Yeah. Where do we get the data from when we issue a command select star from some table? Say I may be an end user where I may be interacting with the user-defined menu, I mean, by an application menu, UI, and I chose reports and customer-wise report, and I got my data served. Maybe you all are DBAs and developers, and you wrote select star from the table yourself, and you got the data served. From where do we get the data shown to us?
Storage. From storage, it will be retrieved.
That is the job of the storage engine, right? So I am talking about the rendering. How, from where does it render the data to us?
Through API?
Of course, yes, but that is the UI, right? With the help of API and the UI, it renders. How, from where exactly is it giving you the data? It is giving us the data from RAM, where the data is loaded and pointer will be facing towards it. Correct? Now, if I am working with a database, what do I call this RAM location with the pointer facing towards it? We call it as a cursor. If I'm going to work with a language like VB, the same RAM location with the pointer facing towards it, we will call it as record set. If I'm going to work with Java, it is the same RAM still, with a pointer facing towards it, but I'll call it as a result set. Similarly, if it is C# I am working with, I would be calling it as a data set. And with all the web technologies like say HTML or let's say XML, the same memory location with the pointer facing towards it, we call it fancifully as DOM tree structure. And if nowadays with Python or R, the same RAM location with the pointer facing towards it, we call it as a data frame. So what I'm trying to bring it to your notice out here is, once you know the core base concepts in computing, switch adapting to the latest technology wouldn't be a big deal. Same thing applies to here in machine learning as well. Yeah. So basically, when Till here, the hardware is given to us. That's your infrastructure as a service. Along with the hardware, if we are provided with the platform, the middle tier and the data management of that tier is taken care of. That's your platform as a service. And if our custom, say, services, software, if any soft specialized software we want to use and the data generated by it is also maintained by the cloud provider, that is your software as a service. So now every cloud, public cloud provider provides you these services to some degree variations. So today the agenda is we are going to learn as a today the in thing is machine learning, robotics, artificial intelligence and data science has gained popularity. Basically, it is again just a terminology where people have been dealing with data from age old days, to from stone age, I would say, and they have been analyzing the data and they have been coming up with models and so on and so forth, which we used to call in the good old earlier days as data mining. And nowadays, the same is called as data science, right? And if you do it on a more specialized category, that analysis is called as deep learning. Yeah. So let's just quickly look into what is machine learning? How? What are all the options does this Azure machine learning service provide us? So when we talk about machine learning as such, yeah, it's a data science technique which is which allows basically the computers to use existing data to forecast future behaviors, outcomes and trends, you would say, without explicitly getting programmed. The everyday, day in and day out, nowadays we use machine learning without even realizing it, and it has become a part and parcel of our life. So we take it for granted. Say morning, in the morning when you leave for office, so you book a Ola or Uber and you find out where exactly have they reached. So your software, that app is able to tell you that. And with the help of Google Map, we are able to easily find out which routes are traffic laden, what we need to avoid, which route we need to take to reach a particular point quickly. Yeah. So be it a health industry, be it a manufacturing industry, be it any sports industry, everywhere, be it a banking industry, every part of the location. Say, for example, you all must be using credit cards. So when we use a credit card, naturally we'll be expected to pay as well after the credit period is over. So when we receive, when we perform a transaction, let's say Chitra is in the habit of spending not more than 5,000 per transaction, and suddenly a transaction shows where 25,000 has been spent, immediately bank will send a notification to me asking me, Chitra, this transaction involves so much amount, did you do this, or if you have not done it, please call us, right? So that is the extent to which the intelligence is given by applications to the different industry for them to be proactive and avoid any mishaps. Yeah, so such is the beauty of machine learning. And when you say Azure machine learning service, it's a platform for operating machine learning workloads in the cloud. So it's a cloud-based environment that can be used to train. Training means you just bring in the data, whatever data that you have, and you apply some algorithm on it and observe. That's called as training. So you can train a model, you can deploy a model, you can automate the process of training and deployment, and you can manage the entire model and track the models also. Yeah, so all these are possible via Azure machine learning service. We can build, train and track accurate machine learning and develop deep learning models, you know, in all in this AML workspace. And this AML workspace or AML service is built on Microsoft Azure Cloud Platform. It allows us to, as you can see in this slide, it allows us to provision resources on demand if I need a lot of processing capability and so many nodes to be added as a part of the cluster, so I am able to easily do it for the machine learning workloads is need. And at the same time, provide data storage and options and connectivity options. Like I can connect to Azure storage, I can connect to Azure Data Lake Store Gen 2 or Gen 1, or let's say I can connect to any of the relational databases. Whatever are the other services which are available as a data store in cloud, most of it allows us to connect to.
Just so a simple question.
So
Azure Machine Learning is a platform as a service, right?
Yeah, correct. It is.
Okay.
So it allows us to ingest data from a wide range of sources for which this data storage and connectivity aspect helps us. And we can, this ML workflow orchestration will allow us to automate model training, deployment and management process from end to end. All the steps in my analytical pipeline could be operationalized easily. And then once I have trained the model and I'm happy with it, I will need to register the model and create an image out of it so that I can deploy it as a web service for people to consume it from their variant client applications. Yeah, so model registration and management is also a part and parcel of the feature which is provided by Azure Machine Learning Service. And it also maintains version controlling. Yeah, as and when you train the model with changes and you run it again, different that versioning is also maintained. And whichever is giving you the best outcome, that model you can deploy. And whatever metrics which are generated by that can be monitored. And finally, we can deploy the model for real time and batch inferencing. So all these are the services which are offered by the Azure Machine Learning Service. Now let us see what are all the artifacts which are needed to work with Azure Machine Learning Service. So the moment you say you will want to work with a machine learning service, the topmost artifact you would get is a work group. But then let us understand, as per this slide, what one requires to talk to Azure Cloud. Okay, you will need to have a specific account, which will be a Microsoft account, which means Outlook account or Hotmail ID or a Live ID. So that kind of a email account you need to have. And then you can either go for trial subscription or you can go for paid subscriptions, right? So even though you may have an email ID to connect to the portal, anybody can connect to the portal, but can they create resources and work with it? For doing that, they will need to have a subscription, like how we subscribe for magazines and newspapers. Like that, with any cloud provider, if we are interested in using their resources that are provided by them, we need to have a subscription. And once I have the email account and a subscription, I can go and create resources. So what is the use of a resource group? Basically, resource group, earlier when Azure was introduced, at that time Microsoft had was using classic Windows service, wherein, say for example, I'm a consultant, so I have clients like say Accenture, Capgemini, Infosys, Wipro, TCS, like that. For everything, I'm handling some project or other, I would want to ensure that none of the company's resources are used in a wrong perspective. So I will want to create whatever resources are needed for a particular company. I would want to do it. And once I have done, I will not do it for free. I will want to charge them for whatever, because I am also incurring the expenses with Microsoft by buying resources from Microsoft's cloud platform, and then I'm doing that work on their behalf. So I would want to charge them for it. For calculating the bill became a very tedious process in the service, classic service model, because they were all individual services. I have to go into individual services and then find out what is the consumption, accordingly calculate the cost. And moreover, once I have done the project and I have done the say handover, at that time I would not want to maintain those resources with me anymore. So I would want to get rid of those resources once I have done the handover. If in case of Windows services, I would have to go and individually delete those resources. Instead, in case of resource group, I will have one location with this group, acts like a folder in our normal OS level, wherein we would have provisioned all the resources and they would all be available within this resource group. And I can, if I get rid of the resource group, even if I may have created thousands of services, all of them will get deleted in a single go. That's the beauty of the resource group provisioning. So this is called as also Azure Resource Temp Manager Template, ARM template, it's called as. So you can automate the process of provisioning of all these resources with the help of these ARM templates. So within a resource group, how do I track all the artifacts which I have created for one machine learning project for a particular entity? That is where the workspace comes in. Workspace acts like a container within which I would be provided with all these other resources, like compute. It could be an individual compute instance, or it could be a cluster, or it could be a container service, yeah, which are managed by Azure Kubernetes. So all my Python code, I would have used Jupyter Notebook to create them, and then I would have stored it. I may have operationalized the pipeline creation activity, where I would have ingested data, I would have retrained the model, I would have registered the model. All that would happen through this. And all the variety of disparate sources I can connect to by using the data stores. I can write also back to this data store, not just read from it. And what is an experiment? Experiment is nothing but a set of instructions which I am running, which I have written in Python and or through designer or through automated machine learning experiment. I am running it on compute. So it's just a process or a script which gets executed. And as an end result, we have a model. Model is just a sample replica of the object which I'm going to use it for predicting my future trends and patterns and outcomes. Yeah. So these, whatever models that got registered, you will be able to see. So all these will be a part and parcel. They will all be stored within a workspace. What about these? The moment I create a machine learning workspace, Microsoft will automatically provide me with these other resources as well. Why? By default, I would want to store my data somewhere, and from some storage, I would want to read. So Microsoft Machine Learning Service gives me automatically two default storage service, which is the blob service and a file service. So those storage account will be maintained here. And if I want to gain application insights from whatever data and the model, that will be here. All the passwords and credential secrets, those would be preserved in the key vault. And for compute, virtual machines I can provision. And if I would have used containers, Azure Kubernetes service will be managing that, so that information will be maintained in the container registry. Any questions, any doubts in this quickly? Anybody?
Yeah. So suppose in one resource group, I have created a machine learning model and I want to use
machine learning workspace. Huh?
Yeah, in that workspace, I've created one machine learning model, and in another resource group, I want to use exactly the same model. So can I share that model from one resource group to another resource group?
Sharing, I wouldn't say is allowed out here, but collaboration, everybody working on the same workspace can share it. But if you want to use a model which I've created through one into another, these models, once you register, will create a pickle file that you can use it in the other environment.
Okay.
So when I say creating a machine learning workspace, these two things are crucial. Now, why are they considered as crucial? The region where you will create the machine learning service, because it's not that every region has all the resources in it. For example, I may be trying to create a image processing model which requires graphical processing units rather than CPU, central processing unit. So GPU kind of systems may not be available in every region. So in Sony, certain regions might have these NC series virtual machines. So I region, that's the reason why it is crucial. And when I say addition, Microsoft Machine Learning, Azure Machine Learning Service comes in two different editions. One is a basic edition, second is the enterprise edition. Basic edition comes with only the core components, like, you know, it comes with the compute, it comes with the basic SDK, it comes with the storage. Yeah, that's what is available when you say core services. When I say if I am a novice, many a time what happens nowadays, that's the kind of population also where it, they are more. They may be novice in data science and they may be wanting to learn data science and take up job opportunities based on that. So how do I learn when I have absolutely no idea what is featuring, what is prediction, and what is hyper tuning, or what are the different types of algorithms? When do I use what? How do I create a model and train the model and test the model? When I have absolutely no idea, the best aspect is you can use the visual designer, which gives you the drag and drop environment, where I will do the drag and drop and create the experiment very quickly, run it, test it, and from that I can learn. Yeah. So same way, if I have no idea which are the hyper parameters which will give me the best effect on the algorithm which I have chosen and give me the accurate results, more precise results, then I can use automated ML user interface, which will help me to fine tune automatically the hyper parameters. Plus it will pick up ready-madely the feature selection, feature engineering, and what are all the different permutation combinations that you should supply. All that optimal run would be auto-selected in automated ML. So with these two features, I can easily find out, but this will not be available in the basic edition. So today also I'm going to create a enterprise edition so that I can support, I can use these features. Data drift is the change in the data, what has happened in the model, so that new data also is considered while predicting. So what are the different tools one can use while to work with machine learning, interact with machine learning service? One is Azure Machine Learning Studio, which is a drag and drop kind of an environment, as you can see in the slide. Second, I can, if I'm a Python developer and I know how to perform analytics using Python, I can very well write my code in Python and get it done. Or I can use in cross-platform environment, Azure Machine Learning, that command line interface. With those commands also, I can handle resources. Or I can also use the Jupyter Notebook. Last, I could also use the VS Code extensions, wherein, like a Visual Studio, I would have the environment where I can create these machine learning service models and so on and so forth and work with it. The entire Python library SDK is supported there. So these are the tools with which you can create. So when you say this machine learning designer, it's a drag and drop. It allows you to create your models in a very easy manner without having to know in depth what each and everything stands for. That's the beauty of this machine learning designer. And this is a sample designer pipeline with varying different modules, where, as you can see, our data got ingested, which got normalized. Now, when I say normalized, ensure that your data doesn't have variance or bias so that the prediction is also accurate. Yeah, so such kind of normalization is done in this. And when you say z-score, here, and since it is written here, I'm talking about it. This is again a mechanism by which you will create a standardization. It's called standard score. It gives you a how far from the mean data point is. That's what is, so how far your data value is deviating from the mean is what it is, it will give you. So then always when you have the data, say you have about, let's say 50,000 records with us in the data set. Humans by nature are lazy inherently. So I don't want to sit and type all those data. Out of that 50,000, I can tell the computer 75% of it you use it for learning. Like machine learning, or machine also learns. How does it learn? By considering, going through the data that we supply to it. Like how we humans learn by constant observation, listening, yeah? And then we learn something. Similarly, computer also learns from the huge volume of data that we supply. So out of that 50,000 records, I can tell the computer boss, use 75% of that 50,000 data to learn from whatever trends and patterns you want to identify. And the remaining 25%, you use it as a testing data. So as you can see here in this graph, split data, the training data is passed to the training model. And the testing data goes to the scoring. Scoring means basically you're checking the accuracy of your trained model. How accurately can it predict? So that's what is being tested there, which is getting evaluated. How closely it has got predicted is what is getting evaluated. So all these processes could be encased within a pipeline. So just that's what this slide is talking about. And when you say training, whatever data you have, you are going to apply some mathematical or statistical function to come up with the result. So basically that kind of a function is what is called as a algorithm. Now, when I say algorithm and what kind of algorithm one would use when and how to choose between different algorithms, how do we decide this? Yeah, which algorithm to opt for? So basically the algorithm we will select depends primarily on two different aspects. One, what do you want to do with your data? So specifically this would be the business question answer you want to answer by learning from that existing data. And second is, what are the requirements of your data science scenario? Specifically, what are you looking for? On that basis, you will decide on the algorithm. For example, if I want to predict between several categories of things which are available, let's say movie recommendation is there, the genre of movie I'm trying to predict. So what are the different values, whether something is a comedy, tragedy, romance, action, suspense, thriller, whatever are the categories. So once when I supply the movie details to my model, it should be able to predict whether it is a suspense movie, thriller movie, or action movie, or whatever that way. So that is your classification algorithm. I'm trying to predict between several categories, which is called as multi-class classifier, or even I can have a binary classifier. For example, in a health industry, when people are undergoing, as per this diabetic set, right? So after supplying the diabetes data, I want to declare via my model whether somebody is diabetic or non-diabetic. So it's just two options. So binary classification. Supposing, let's say I want to find out unusual occurrences in my data point, identify rare or let's say anomaly. So that anomaly detection, I would be using anomaly detection algorithm. And then let's say I have no idea in the classification, at least I have an idea what is the outcome I'm trying to predict. But many a time you may not have that answer in unsupervised category of algorithms, which is clustering, right? Or let's say if I'm trying to predict answer questions like how much or how many, I may be using regression algorithm. So all this, the kind of algorithm you will try to use or you will apply would depend on the requirement of the business question which you are trying to answer. So when after applying that mathematical or statistical function using a particular type of algorithm on the large amount of data, that is what is the process is what is called as training. And once I have trained a model, I'll verify its accuracy. I'll evaluate which one is the best and then accordingly I'll deploy. I could also use custom code modules as a part of my machine learning pipeline which I have created or model which I have created. It could be one among any one of these. And once I have created a trained pipeline and I found that it is giving me the best performance and accurate result, I would want to deploy it in my production environment. So how if I want to deploy it as a web service so that all the applications can consume it, how will I do it? That's where you will, and if I want as and based on the changes in the data, I want the prediction to be immediate. So that's where I'll go for a real-time inference pipeline. But if I have some batch jobs to be done, I can go for a batch pipeline as well. If it is a web service, when I'm there, deploying it as a web service, it'll add a web service input and a web service output, and it will remove all the statistical steps from the graph. As you can see, there is no split data module, no train module are there. All of them have been removed. And my those statistical model, whatever model I trained, has been declared, has been added here as a data set. These are all the changes that would happen when you will deploy your trained pipeline as a web service. And how do I consume it? As I said, two different types of web service, right? I can have a batch pipeline or a real-time pipeline. So I will have a service endpoint created, which will be a HTTP service endpoint. And I can also interact with these endpoints with the help of REST API. Let's quickly go and create a model. Since we are running out of time, we have got 1 hour only. So what I'll any questions so far in these concepts? Anybody, everybody?
Yeah. So during pipeline, when we create our model, so is there any point that we may face any data limitation, data size limitation, and compute resource limitation? And it can be handled by Azure automatically?
Yeah, yeah. That also can be done. And basically, it can deal with petabytes of data. So, I mean, the question of you encountering the limitations in the handling of data, if you would have used a data lake store, it's pretty easy to deal with.
Okay.
So let me, since my mail is there, let my mail be there. If in case by accidentally I get out of the team meeting, let me open a new incognito window. And to connect to portal, Azure portal, you would say portalazure.com. And provide the email ID which has access to a particular subscription. Let me provide the password. Once it is done, we'll be taken to the portal. And once inside the portal, let me create a resource. Create a resource, anything you want to create. Say just a quick introduction to the portal. On the left hand side, you have some menu which is called as a breadcrumb menu. Don't ask me why, God alone knows. It's just the name that's been given. And where you would find often used commands, you can pin it up over here. Okay. And on top right, you have certain tools. Cloud Shell will allow you to go to a prompt where you can run your Azure CLI commands or PowerShell commands. And if you want to switch between different directory and subscriptions, you can do it. Any notification that portal has to give you, it will happen via this bell symbol. And system settings, you can change like theme and background settings and so on and so forth. Any help you need, you can ask for it from Azure using by clicking over here. Any feedback, if you're interested, you can give it there. So let's click on create a resource, and we'll be shown this marketplace from where I'll select AI plus machine learning, and from there I should select the machine learning option. And once I do that, it will take me to a GUI where it will ask me to provide some input. So I'm going to create a new resource group. Let me create it as AMLRG. And workspace name, let me call it as TSRWS. I want to create it in East US 2, and the workspace edition I want to create is enterprise. Do I want to locate, search for the service with a particular keyword? Then I can give it a tag. I'm not going to do that right now. Let me click on review create. System will validate, and once it validation is successful, we will be able to click on that create button. Let me click on the create button where it will provision the resource. And in the meantime, to show you variations, let me, while it is underway, let me go and create a storage account of my own so that I can use it to register my storage account. So I'm just quickly creating one using the same AMLRG. And account name, let me give it as TSRACC, and East US 2 performance is standard because I want all the services to be available, and version 2 I'll go for because I want access tier plus the time all the services. Let me go for locally redundant storage. I spoke of every cloud platform should give you high availability, right? So as that process, by default, Azure will maintain 3 copies of your data. So that is your LRS, locally redundant, because all the 3 copies will stay in the same data center, but in different racks. For example, paint is already on. So in a particular data center, if I have three different racks like this, they are called as a fault domain, and I may have update domains. These are my update domains. Because every software will have some patches and updates to be applied, security updates to be applied, right? So these are my fault domains. When I say 3 copies, so how those 3 copies will be maintained? It will be maintained like this. So that, let us say this is fault domain 1 and fault domain 2. I'm bad in this. Writing on a blackboard is pretty easier than this. Still, let me try. Update 1, update 2. Update 3 domain. So let us say this rack failed and an update is happening on this copy. Still, you will have one more copy with which to serve, right? That's how I've just chosen LRS. We can also, but then if the entire data center goes down in LRS, you lose your data. You don't have availability then. So that's where we go for zone redundancy, where we have copies in 2 different data centers. So I will have 6 copies. So one entire data center goes down also, I'll have other. And in extreme conditions, like how it happens in every organization for their production databases as best practice, we would have minimum 5 DR copies on geographically apart location. Likewise, we can go for here, geo redundancy. where I can have my copies stored in the paired region so that I will be having 12 copies if I go for geo zone redundancy. So let me just quickly choose this and click on OK. And create a container. In the meantime, let me see whether my, yeah, this got provisioned. Machine learning service got provisioned. Let me go to that. So this machine learning resource, if I have come to the machine learning workspace, as I said, these resources would get automatically created except registry. Why? I have not created any containers for processing. So when I do through my environment, it will get registered here. Okay, I'll show it to you when we do that. So if I click on launch studio, it will open up in another screen with the same credentials being passed, and it will take me to a GUI. In the meantime, while this is loading, let me go and access a storage account. And in the storage account, I have file service, blob service, tables and queues. So let me go to blob service. I don't have a container, so let me create a container called, say, my container. And this should not be accessible to anybody till I don't give permission. So private, no anonymous access. And within this container, I'll load some data. So in my let's say I have this data. So I'll copy this path. And when I click on upload, it asks me to select the blob. So I can paste the path and go to the location and pick up the file and upload. So once the data is uploaded, I can register this account also as my storage account in my machine learning studio. So it's telling me, choose your directory, choose your workspace. There. This is a tour, so let's not go through that. We are brought into the machine learning studio. Now it has varying sections. It has authoring section. If I am a developer who is well versed with Python, I can directly go to notebooks and then start writing my code. If it is a wizard which I want to go through, where I want the computer to help me out with everything, I would go through automated ML. And if I'm going to design a solution myself, I'll come down to designer. These are all the assets which are there, which I told you. So far, we have not created any experiment. So now it is empty. Similarly, no pipeline has been created. No model has been registered. No endpoint has been created. No data sets also have been registered. Compute also, we don't have anything. We'll create them dynamically. And data stores also, I said two default storage, right? One is a blob store, other one is a file store. These are the default storage. So when we will also learn how to register our own storage once the uploading is completed. Yeah. Let's quickly design. So right now I'm going to, today's exercise, I'm going to take you through designer. So let me go to designer and I'm going to click on plus sign to create. And this is the canvas I will get. And the exercise which I'm going to take you through is basically for predicting the price of an automobile given some information, yeah, to the users. So that's what we are going to do. Basically, this will this example will help us to train and deploy a machine learning model which will predict the price of any car. Given certain features. So we, as a process, we will create a new pipeline, which we have done just now. Sorry, we will use the data prepare the data, train the model, evaluate it, and deploy it. That is the step I'm going to take you through. So first of all, let's go and change the name of the model. I don't want this weird looking with the timestamp and whatever. So let us say DP car price prediction. So that's the name we have given. So it has saved it accordingly, and it is empty as of now. I want to use a data set. If you look at it, there are n number of sample data sets which are there. I can load, bring my own data also. That is possible, which I'll show you after registering our information. So in this case, I'm going to use automobile price data, where I'm going to show you how many records are there in this. So if you click on output, you will get to visualize the data, wherein there are 205 rows and 26 columns. Yeah, there are so many columns which are there, including the price. OK, so another important aspect before we proceed ahead, let me quickly take you through the equivalent concepts in machine learning. Say, for example, you all must be familiar with OOP, right? OOPs or OOP? Is it OOPs or OOP? Hello, anybody?
Yeah.
So when do we say OOPs? When we goof up, right? So it came with a purpose. It's object-oriented programming. So what are the principles of OOP? What is OOP first, quickly?
Hello? Object-oriented programming.
Yeah, great. That's a full form. So what is it? It's an approach towards. So what are the features of OOP here? Data abstraction, data encapsulation, inheritance. By virtue of inheritance, we'll have to deal with polymorphism. So what is data abstraction, which is what I'm going to explain a parallel in AML. What is this data abstraction? Anybody? Quickly, please. Hello?
Yeah, it means showing only essential details, hiding complexity.
Right, so can you give me an example? Okay, you combined two different things. So let's talk about the first statement, showing the essential things. So what do you mean by that? Can you give us an example?
Yeah, we can say that mobile phone. Mobile phone is abstract function. We don't know how the call is getting connected to other person and those things.
So that would be encapsulation, right? I want to know what is abstraction. Hiding the complexity would be encapsulation. So when we say,
is it about being able to create logical views without, you know, physically touching the data?
Sort of, you could say. For example, let us say now this being the COVID situation, sadly. We have been hired by hospitals to create a bill generation solution application. We have been hired by a university to generate the statement of marks for the students. We have been hired by the banks to create a statement of transaction. We have been hired by, let's say, a company to generate their payslip. So for the bill application, billing application of hospital, what data would I trap? Hello? If I have to track some data for a patient, what data would I?
Maybe number of tests conducted.
Okay. Whatever tests the person has undergone, the test results, any medical history,
yes,
that past that person has, what is that person allergic to, the person's name. Yeah.
The doctor.
I also want to, yeah, the doctor who is attending to that person. I would also want to know their financial status so that I know they are capable of booting the bill. And say their qualification. Yeah. Hello? Whatever medicines they have been, I'm not telling you anything, I'm asking you here. Medicines are taken, yeah. So why do I need a qualification? As a doctor, if somebody is, if my patient is an illiterate, will I not treat him? That is my duty to treat him, whether somebody is literate or illiterate. So this feature or a characteristic is not relevant. So when you say data abstraction is essential details or relevant details, dealing with relevant details, this is what it means. For whichever domain within which you are trying to represent an entity, the relevant characteristics within that domain for that entity is what you should take. For example, if I'm talking about the university application, there will I ever care about what a student, which disease he or she is suffering from? I couldn't care less. But at the same time, I will be 100% concerned with the academic progress of that person because he or she is trying to pursue their higher studies, right? So what is necessary, the characteristics or the data that we will pick up will depend on the domain within which we are trying to represent that entity, be it a patient, be it a student, be it a customer, be it an employee. All of them are humans, right? Whether they behave like one or not is a different issue altogether, but still, supposedly human. But for the same human, when they are treated as a patient, I will be worried about concerned with a different set of attributes for them. When I'm looking at that person as a student, same human as a student, I will be dealing with different data as a customer, as a employee. Yeah. So that is the essential characteristics. Here, whatever is called as data abstraction is called as feature engineering in data science parlance. Picking up or reducing your attributes to whatever essential features which will have a impact on the outcome of the prediction, they are, that process of finding those characteristics or data points is called as feature engineering, and the actual data is called as features. Okay. And the outcome I'm trying to predict is called as labels. The target value I'm trying to target value to be predicted is called as labels. And if I know already the kind of answer I'm supposed to get as an outcome, such a type of algorithm is called as supervised algorithms, where I know the outcome that is expected. When I have absolutely no idea as to what is the outcome that is expected, they are called as unsupervised algorithm, right? So when we go to the studio, I have the data and we saw that it is having 26 different attributes. So I will have to, many a time when you use a data, when you load the data for, or when you gather the data for analysis, it may not be readily consumable. So you may have to profile the data, like out of it, you have to ensure that no null values are there. Because if you are creating a contact database and out of 100 names, 100 data which you have collected, by say 80 data is not having the first name, last name, or their contact numbers, what's the earthly use of having such a data, right? So we need to make sure that there aren't null values, and we need to ensure that whatever data attribute as per characteristics we have picked up as a column has a bearing on the prediction I'm going to do. On that basis, I find that normalized losses is not having any bearing on my prediction, so I want to exclude it. Otherwise, rest of all, I want to include, let's say, as a example. So once I have brought in the data, I would want to do select certain columns, right, from the data set. So I'll drag and drop, select columns in a data set, and I will have to connect these modules for the data to flow through. Okay, so in this, I've got a triangle here because computer is telling me, Chitra, you have not selected any columns as yet. Because, okay, so here I'll click on edit columns. And, okay, a quick question. In any database table, how many columns, maximum number of columns can we have per single table? Any idea? In any RDBMS product and you are creating a table, how many maximum columns you can have? 1024. Let's say I have made a table with 800 columns and I have value for only 100 columns. How will I add the data? Because if I don't provide a value for those rest of the columns, computer will tell me number of columns and number of values applied don't match. So then at least to avoid that error, I will have to dump in remaining 700 column values as null. That will be a time pass job, right? So what I can do, when I'm using the insert statement, I can tell the computer, boss, out of 800 columns, I'm going to provide value for only these whatever 100 columns values that I have, right? Such a thing is what I'm going to do. I'm going to tell the computer, select all columns. After selecting all columns, exclude the column which I don't want. So a particular column name, so I can select normalized losses. That's easier way, right? Rather than including individually all those columns separately. Understood? So I have chosen the columns which I want to add. And what will I do? How am I going to handle the missing values there? So I can use a clean missing data module, drag and drop, and connect it. And here I can say, all columns I want to select. And how do I want to treat if there are any missing values? Like even no missing value, I will tolerate. That is this. Okay. So how do I want to clean it? Now, I can clean it in these multiple layer. 1 minute. I was trying to minimize this. So these are all the different ways in which I can substitute or clean a missing value. I can give a substitute value, maybe where numbers are involved, where wherever a value is not there, put 0 or put NA for not applicable or whatever. Or I can replace it with mean, median, all this. Or I can remove the entire column or row. So here I'm saying, if an entire row is missing or a majority of the row is missing, what's our use of having the data? I'll say remove that row. And ideally, here right now, I'm just doing things fast so that within stipulated time, we have to finish it. Otherwise, ideally in production environment, you should do the comment and all properly as a best practice. So that, because most of the time we'll be expected to work on maintenance project than a fresh project. So how in God's name will I know why somebody wrote or did something for whatever they have done so far as a part of the model? So documentation is essential. So we have cleaned the data. Having done that, I'm out of 205 rows. I want to tell the computer how much data it can take. So I'm going to use split data module. So I'll embed in drag and drop and connection. Wait. There, split data. By default, computer is telling me Chitra 50-50. So I'm going to make it as 80-20. So 0.8. And what does this seed and stratified split mean? Seed is like every time, it's a random split, right? But every time when I do this, I want to get the same set of records to be pulled out, I'll provide a seed. Stratified split means whether is it, if I say true, that means I'm telling the computer my split is based on a particular column's value, which is not so. So after splitting data, we are trying to predict the price, right? How much will be the price? How much or how many will be answered by regression algorithm we set? So I'm going to use linear regression. So let me drag and drop it here. And I want to tell the computer with this data, applying this mathematical or statistical functions, you train the model. So train model is the module which I'll drag and drop. How will I connect? I should tell the computer boss, use this function. And there are two output port, right? What do they for? First output port is for the data to be trained. So I want the computer to learn from my data. So I have done that. So once I connect it, computer is telling me, Chitra, okay, tell me the label column. Label means we said something which we are trying to predict, the target value which you are trying to predict. So what are you trying to predict is what it is asking me. So I'll just go here and specify the column name, which is price. And it is case retentive. Huh? I wouldn't say case sensitive. Jaisa, whatever way it is appearing in your data set, same way you should type it here. In my data set, it is in fully in small case. So I have used it here. And I'm said I want to predict the price considering the features which I have supplied. Clear? Now, whatever I have trained the model, how accurate is it? I need to find it. So I'll bring up a score model here. Score also, I will have to tell the computer, use the sample model which I have trained, which has the information, and use the remaining 20% of data, because we had split it as 80-20, right? So that remaining 205 is 100%, out of which 80% should go as trained data, 20% should come as a test data. So with this model, with this test data, check the accuracy, which we will evaluate. So evaluate model. And why evaluate model is having two inputs? I can evaluate it based on multiple different algorithms. So maybe if I compare, which one is giving me the best outcome? I can do so. So, but here I'm using only one. So I have created the model, right? So now this model, I want to run it. Check whether it is correct. How can I run it? Where will it run? For running, it will require a compute. And I showed you here, we don't have any compute, right? So let's go back to the designer and see. I'll go to the pipeline and I'll click on submit. Computer will tell me, Chitra, you don't have a compute, select a compute. So I'll click on select compute. We don't have any compute with us, so I'm going to create new. Computer has given me a standard default configuration, which is fair enough for us. So I'm going to call it as Chitra compute. And I'll create. So what does 0 by 2 means? It's creating a cluster with two nodes. When the model is not running, experiment is not running, zero nodes will be allocated, so no compute cost. But once my experiment is running, maximum will be two nodes. Right now for training, I've just taken two nodes. Depending on your workload, in live production environment, you would use the appropriate compute, okay? So let us check whether by refreshing whether it is succeeded. So it is succeeded and selected. And click on save. So now that we have created a compute, let me click on submit. So it will ask me, Chitra, your entire pipeline has to run as an experiment. As it's a process, right? So do you have an experiment from where you can choose? We don't have. So I'll create it and let me call it as DP car experiment. And this is the compute that it will use. And let's click on submit. So this is going to take a good 10 to 12 minutes. It will. Because training a model, it will go through each and every module that I've used. As you can see here, there's a gray sign. When everything is successful, I'll find a green tick mark here on each and every one of these modules. And once that is done, once everything has turned green, only then I'll be able to publish it as a web service. I can see what stage it is in by clicking on this overview, run overview. If I go to output and logs, a new screen will open where I'm able to see what is happening. If I click on execution logs, I'll be able to see what is happening right now. It has submitted it. So if I go to experiment, let us see whether an experiment is there. We gave a name DP car experiment, right? So it created the experiment, but that is what is running. If I click on it, it will give me the running information. See, running one. Nothing is completed. So if I click on this run ID, I can see step by step what is happening. My entire graph will be shown to me. And which step is running, I can see here. Clear with this? Let us wait for it to complete. In the meantime, anybody, any questions? In whatever I have done so far.
Can this pipeline be executed outside Azure ML once we test it and once we found
Yes. Outside Azure ML as in, you can operationalize it as a pipeline in Azure DevOps. I can use this pipeline and run it via Data Factory as a part of another data pipeline. So it integrates pretty much with every environment.
Even outside Azure environment?
Not Azure environment. Within Azure, different this.
Okay.
And I'm sure like how integration for Amazon is given for some extent to certain services in Azure platform, similar thing would be there. So if it is there, then you will be able to borrow in any of the cloud providers' environment.
Okay, thanks.
Welcome. In the meantime, let's see how to register a data store while this is going on. So click on data store on from under manage. So right now my experiment is running. So whatever the sample data set which is there, which I've used, right? So that's got registered here. But I want to register a new data store. So let me click on new data store. Let's call it as a blob store. And these are the These are the different types of data stores which are supported as of now via Machine Learning Studio. Okay. Blob store, file share, data lake store, Gen 1, Gen 2. Azure SQL database, MySQL database, Postgres, all these are what are supported. So I'm going to select blob storage. Computer is telling me, okay, Jitra, from this, what is the subscription? Select your account name. So I'm going to select this TSR ACC. What is the container? My container. Account key, or I can use SAS token. So I'm going to use account key, for which we have to pick up the account key. So here the uploading has taken place. Let me go back to the account. There is an access key under settings. I will copy the key one and I'll supply it here. Never should you share your key with anybody. Otherwise, that person becomes God in your own storage account. So you should ideally create a SAS token for the resource which somebody has to use. Since this is my environment I'm using, I've taken the key. And if I click on create, if everything is successful, it'll add that store here. Okay, so which I can use, say for example, it's a new pipeline I'm creating. How will I use this? I can click on data input and output, go to import data. Rather than using ready-made data sets, I can import my own data. So computer is asking me, Chitra, from where are you trying to pull it out? From the URL via HTTP or data store? Data store. So there I'll select blob store. So within my data store, what is the path where my data is available? I'll have to select which file. Na? So my container, this select file, I'll select and say save. And it will validate it. If it is successful, validated will be there and I'll be able to see the schema of it, depending upon whatever is the data which is there. Then from this, actually this data set is for predicting which customer would go in for a particular fixed deposit scheme in my bank or in my financial institution. So, sorry. So for in all these data, how does day of the week matter? So I'm going to deselect it. I can deselect it and then take it as a feature. Okay, so all that I can do, or instead of doing it here I'll bring in select column data set. And then there I can choose whatever I want to add and whatever I want to discard. Okay, but in this time it will not show me the column names because this has not been run. Only if I run it, the column will be available because now I'm importing from a different location, right? Earlier it was available because it was available as a global data set already registered with machine learning. So it showed me those column names. For example, I'll show you what I mean by that. If I go here, I will say like last time, add all columns. I want to only exclude day of the week. So if I go to day exclude and go to columns, see, it's telling me that I had to run this experiment before those names columns could be listed. Whereas last time when I brought it here, I got the list of columns. That was what I was referring to. Let us see what is the status of our pipeline which is running. Still running. Yeah, so far so good. So like that, once everything is done, tick mark will be there in all the modules. So if I go to, let me once split data get done, then I'll take you there so that you will get to see two different data sets created because we have broken it down as 80 and 20. So 80% of 205 will be in one result set. 20% of it will be in the other data set. Any questions, anybody? In the meantime, there, split data is done. Na? So if I select split data and if I click on output and logs, it will take a while to show me. So here it would show me basic output there, data set 1 and data set 2 will show yours. May I request you to mute, please? Yeah. See, it has taken, this is set 1, this is set 2. So there. Since it has prepared it, it was not ready, it was not showing. It is now showing me data outputs. This is a data set 1. If I click at it, 80% of 205 will be picked up here, which is 154. And the remaining, whatever 50, 60 records, jo bhi rahega. Whatever number of records is left out is out here. So it is going through step by step. We can easily find out if I click on refresh, I'll get to see the status and which step is running. We can find out from here. Whatever are completed, we'll get to see completed, whichever is running, it'll tell us. First time training the model will take a while, definitely. Here, everything is done, completed. Running has changed into completed. So, how do I know whether the training accuracy is there or not? Let me go to the score model. And if I look at the output, it would have added a new column called as a scored label or a scored price. There. Scored label is a price, right? So this is the actual prices which are available and computer has predicted this. More or less, they are accurate. I wouldn't say this is 100% accurate. Around 86-87% should be accurate. Let's see. So if I go to evaluate model and if I look at the output, show data outputs, you will get to have some information like mean absolute score, right? What does that mean? So if you scroll to the right, you will have, in this, we will have to look up coefficient of determination. So around 84.54, which is 85% accurate. This shows the accuracy. Now, what do these error scores show you? Now, for all the error scores, lower the value, better. Okay. For example, when you say root mean squared error. Okay. Now, what does that mean? It is a square root of the average of all the squared errors of predictions which are made on the test data set. And what is the absolute error? You have absolute error, you have relative squared error. Yeah. When you say relative absolute error, it's an average of absolute errors related to the absolute difference between your actual value and the average of all the actual values. It is predicted the actual values and the average of all the actual values. Similarly, squared error between the difference between the actual value and the average of all actual values, square of that. So for each of these error statistics, as I said, smaller value is better. The smaller value normally indicates that the predictions are closer to the actual value. That's why I said smaller is the best. And for coefficient of determination, the more closer it is value it is to one, the better the prediction will be. So it is almost 85% here. So now that this pipeline has run, okay, so let me go to the, if you go to the pipeline, you will find the pipeline. Earlier, oh, pipeline neither, it is there. Now I want to see if you go to model, no model is there because we had to register the model by deploying it. So I'll go to the pipeline. I will go to the experiment first because we need to deploy this experiment. Let me go to the experiment, run ID. Where this is run. We should get to see an inference pipeline there in that run information. Let me go to designer. No, this is another thing which I created now. Designer, DP card prediction. Can you see an inference pipeline? What is the meaning of this inference pipeline? I said, okay, this will allow you to deploy it as a web service, real-time web service or a batch processing web service I can do. I'm going to create a real-time inference pipeline. And the moment you do, what did I tell you in the slide? It will add a web service input, web service output automatically. Refer to this slide. It will add a module for web service input, web service output, and it will remove all those statistical steps. And I told you the trained model will be shown to you as a data set, and it will get registered once I publish my pipeline. Let us see. It has added a web service input. It has added a web service output. Do we see a split module here or a train module here? No. So this again, I'll have to run and check. Let me run this. For which experiment? Already our experiment is there. So I'll select it. Already compute is there. Let me click on it. Here again, all this should run and I should have a tick mark. And once I have a green tick mark on all these steps, then I will click on deploy, which will register the model and it will create an inference endpoint with which I can interact. Right now, these two things are empty, right? So once it finishes running, once my inference pipeline has started execution. So if I click on it, still I'll be seeing whichever modules are getting evaluated or submit, you will get a green tick mark. So once everything is done, then I can click on deploy, which will deploy the model. Let us just wait this in again, take another 5 to 6 minutes. So as a person who is planning to appear for TP100, then you should be familiar with all these concepts also. Like for normalization, what are all the concepts? For missing values, how will you substitute? Yeah. And sometimes your data set may be skewed, which we call it as an imbalanced data set, where a particular category may be more, a particular category may be less. So if I use such a data set, then my predictions may not be accurate. So I'll have to make sure that I have an equal distribution of those different varieties of categories, for which you will use something called as SMOT or synthetic minority operating characteristics. So that you will include and then generate values so that from the existing value, it will apply some algorithm and auto-generate some value. This is sampling method, basically. Synthetic minority over sampling technique. And it will not simply duplicate your existing data set. It is instead it uses, as I said, an algorithm which takes samples of the feature space for each target class of its nearest neighbor and then generate new values. So you in your examination, they would ask you questions on these concepts. How do you deal with scaling? How do you normalize data? How do you deal with missing values? Plus, what kind of module in Python you would use to handle SDK kind of a thing. All these you should know. Then the different computes, when do you go for what? For example, if you go to compute, you have a variety of category. You have compute instance, which is an individual machine. Whatever machine I created is under compute cluster, which is used by the, machine learning studio, and inference clusters are not there. If I have to run my deployed model, it will ask me to create a AKS cluster machine. See, whatever clusters we had created are shown here. And under compute instance, I have nothing, no individual machine and no containers I've created. Attached computers, already if I happen to have a Hadoop cluster or Databricks cluster on-premise and I want to add it here and then use it, I can do that. And we go to inference pipeline and check how much of it is done. Everything is done. So this is completed. So now I can deploy. Once I deploy, it will tell me, Chitra, you don't have a inference cluster. This is what I was referring to. So before I could deploy, I should create an inference cluster myself. So let me go to compute, create inference clusters. Maybe AML clusters. And I want to create it in East US 2. And I would want to use machine size standard underscore DS2 and V2. This would suffice for my demonstration right now. Everything else, I'm accepting the default. And let me click on create. So once this finishes creation, it will tell me I'll be able to know the provisioning state from here. I can click on refresh and find out. Once this is succeeded, only then I can deploy. Only when I deploy, my model will get registered and my endpoint will get created. So remember, for registering the model and deploying the model, you need a Azure Kubernetes service-based containers. It uses those clusters. It uses. Okay, don't I have a sufficient core or something? Too few agent cores. Acha, ek kaam karti hu main. Iska value ko kam kar dete hain. So I'll select it. Delete. Because I don't have sufficient cores left, so let me create it with one node is fine, just for demonstration both of you. AML clusters and East US 2 node 1. VM size standard V2. ये भी नहीं है I'll have to create it in a different region then. Make it as dev test instead of production. And let me give standard ES2 me hai kya. One node it should allow me to create now. So once this is created only, we'll be able to submit it for deployment, our pipeline, I mean our model rather. So deploying the pipeline registers the pipeline model, and then creates an endpoint which you can consume. So once the endpoint is deployed, you will have a separate tab called a test there, which you can just click at it and test your endpoint by supplying it some values and get the prediction easily. It will take good 5 minutes to create the cluster in Kubernetes. Yeah, in the meantime, anybody, any questions?
Chitra, can you tell us more about the exam structure?
Come again, which structure? Sorry, I couldn't follow you.
The DP100 exam structure.
Exam structure. Yeah. As I said, please one minute.
Can you please low down your microphone? Yeah, much
yeah,
better
so
now.
Let's quickly go back here and let's say deploy, and then I'll answer the question where the deployment is taking place. So now it has picked up our compute. I'll click on deploy. So once the deployment starts, you would find the endpoint and the models here. See, model got registered, which you are not having, and the endpoint also will be shown to you. How do we know that the endpoint, this, it is telling you that it is using AKS compute? And if you click at it, how do you know that deployment is complete? Here itself, you will find the deployment status healthy. It'll right now it is telling you transitioning, then it will tell you preparing, running, finally it will be healthy. And then once it shows you healthy, here between details and consume, you will have a tab called a test, which you can click at it and supply data and consume it directly interactively and test it out. Yeah, so coming back to the exam structure, initially there'll be a set of questions which you will have to answer it. Wherein you cannot go back to it later. Huh? They are not a revisitable module. Such kind around 10 to 15 questions would be of that nature in the first section. Second section will be a combination of questions on your algorithms, the concepts, and certain Python code tidbits to do this. What is the command? Like, for example, you can create a workspace, connect to a workspace or create a workspace, get the context of the workspace two ways. One is from config file, other one is from get function. So probably you may have questions like different permutation combinations will be given as to, then you will have to select what are all the options. And sometimes they may ask you, okay, they may look like multiple options, but they would have framed the question in such a way that only one option is available. So the first section, it is not revisitable. And when you move from section to section also, you cannot go back and mark it for review or whatever. And there will be a lab section also where you will be asked to connect to portal and do something. That's the last part. So your entire time would be distributed amongst these. Yeah, it has become healthy. Now if I click on test, I can use a sample data, whatever it has supplied. And on that basis, I can click on test. This is the data it has supplied, it will give me the prediction. So it has given me a prediction of 13,000 something. Actual price is 13,000. It has given me this as a prediction because it's only 84%, 85% accurate, right? Not fully. That's why you find some differences in the prediction, but nearby it will be clear. That's all from this web forecast. I would request all of you to give your valuable feedback so that we can improvise it further in the subsequent sessions. Yeah, has there been a value add to all of you? Thank you. Have a nice weekend, all of you. Any questions?
So my question will be like, what material we can refer further for preparation in perspective of the exam or something? Like,
go to the Microsoft documentation. Go step by step the entire documentation, you'll be able to crack any question.
Okay. Yeah, thank you.
Welcome. Yeah. Good day.
Thank you so much, Chitra ma'am, for this wonderful session, and thanks everyone for joining the last webinar from this series. So for if anyone is interested in Azure tomorrow's Python webinar workshop, please let me know. I'm sharing my email ID. After some time, I will send you a attendee link for tomorrow's workshop. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you, Chitra ma'am.
Thank you.